non so se vi interessa, noi abbiamo.
So I am a full-time intensivist and proud to be one. We're all working together in a multidisciplinary fashion to fight COVID-19. Together, we are intensive care medicine.
Hello, I'm internal medicine specialist and I'm proud to be an intensivist. We intensivists are working hard to fight for COVID-19. Together, we are intensive care medicine. Thank you.
I am the editor of Intensive Care Medicine Journal. I am proud to be an intensivist. We are working together to fight COVID-19 and to take care also of non-COVID patients. Together, we are intensive care medicine.
I'm a nephrologist and I'm proud to be an intensivist. We intensivists are working together to fight COVID-19. Together, we are intensive care medicine.
I'm an anesthesiologist and I'm proud to be an intensivist. We intensivists are working together to fight COVID-19. Together, we are intensive care medicine.
Hello, good afternoon or good morning, wherever you are in the world. My name is Maurizio Cecconi. I'm the head of anesthesia and intensive care at Humanitas Research Hospital in Milan, and I'm the president of the European Society of Intensive Care Medicine. Today, we open a new format. It's a 30 minutes with, and it's a great pleasure, it's a great honor to have our first guest, Professor Luciano Gattinoni. Luciano Gattinoni does not need an introduction. If I have to read his short CV, probably we would fill the full 30 minutes, so I'm not going to do that. But for everyone to know, he's now is a guest professor at the University of Göttingen. And so, welcome, Luciano.
Ciao, Maurizio, and good evening, good day, good morning to everybody.
How are you, Luciano?
Okay.
Luciano, let me ask the first question, because I know that you are in Germany now, but everyone knows that you've been in Milan for many, many years. You retired a few years ago. So what are you actually doing in Göttingen now?
In Göttingen, we have an excellent research group. We have in part from Germany, in part from Italy. And we do basically experimental medicine. So a quite long-term experiment. We try to have the intensive care in a Schwein, in a German pigs, for at least 48 hours, which a long-term, I think we learn a lot of things. And we concentrate basically on the possible damages on mechanical ventilation, plus a sepsis, plus something else.
The question is, you retired, I don't remember how many years ago, from Milan. Why are you still doing research? What motivates you to do research?
To do what else, you know, because you have two alternatives when you retire, no? To go with the dogs to see how the people build houses and so on. But first, I didn't have a dog, and I still had some curiosity. So I think the curiosity was the main driver of my life. And so I think then you can add many other things, no? To grow up, some people, blah, blah, blah. But the basic drive is the curiosity. And this is a never-ending process.
So I agree with you. I think that's the curiosity is what keeps us alive in our profession. Clinical research and you know, education, it's all of that together, but specifically in research. Today, I'm not going to ask you questions about COVID, by the way. Everyone is asking questions about COVID these days. Maybe there will be some from social media, we will see. I'm reminding everyone that you can participate. We have our social media team scouting for questions online. But let me ask first something to you. You've been a mentoring, you've been a model for many of us in intensive care, an inspiration to go to intensive care. What inspired you to go into intensive care? I don't even know if I can say, was it 30 years ago, 40 years ago? What was intensive care already a specialty at the time? What motivated you to go there?
Well, absolutely not. Well, my motivation was my friend, Iapichino, came to me after we were graduated medical degree after a couple of months, and he told me, you know, I found what is perfect for us. What is perfect for us is the applied physiology. And we have a space for applied physiology. So we arrived in a small piece, and we were all students together. We don't have anybody before us. So we were free to do whatever mistake we wanted, but everybody was loving the applied physiology. Whatever we would do was oriented in that way. And physiology means mathematics, means physics, means bioenergetics, means this kind of thing. To understand the mechanism, not the outcome. The mechanism on the basis of outcome. This was the driving to go to intensive care. And you do something and you see the results. You have a system, your perturbation of the system, and you see immediately the result. You note and you grow.
So I like what you said. I think it's again something that many of us can relate about intensive care, is this continuous physiology in front of us. But of the many fields, many aspects of physiology, I often like to think that the intensivist is the doctor that looks after the whole body. It's not just one system, it's not just the lungs, it's not just the heart and so on. But in the specific, you had a strong passion and a strong drive to go specifically in the field of respiratory failure. Why was that? Was it a natural encounter, or was it what was it that made you explore so much respiratory failure?
Well, as many other things in life, they happen by chance. Because I had an occasion to go to the United States. I didn't speak one word in English, not much better than now, but you know, even much worse than now. And somebody told me, wait, there is some strange man, his name is Dr. Korobov, which is at NIH, which play with extracorporeal circulation and a sheep. He needs a fellow. Would you like to go? I said, why not? So I arrived in one morning. Don't ask me where I spent the first night in the United States, no idea. So I had a guitar, a repertoire, and a lot of money to try to find a telephone. And at the day after, I came to NIH, I met Korobov. And Korobov was working on a membrane lung, and a new membrane lung. The ECMO was, at the time, was already a failure in terms of trials, the Zeppo trial. And Korobov said, well, why not? Why the CO2? Because he wanted to have a CO2 dialysis. My duty was to test the lung, but I had a lot of physiology behind. I want to test the lung, the artificial lung, how much CO2 was exchanging. Still now, the people does not measure how much CO2 is cleared. Anyway, but I was interested to the lung and to the clearing of the CO2 in the pigs, in the sheep. It was very clear that more CO2 you extract in one side, the spontaneous breathing sheep was decreasing is on ventilation. And so this was the key for the lung rest. Yeah. So we were speaking about the Landex in the 76, 77. Korobov was at least 20 years in advance.
You In a few conversations that you had, you often mentioned Theodor Kolobov and some of the teachings that you say. I think you refer to something sometimes like the experiment of one, or how much you can learn on every single case.
Absolutely. Kolobov was the real research. No? The great difficulty with Kolobov is to put together one paper. Because Kolobov say, okay, did an experiment, changed something during the experiment. At the end, he said, what did you learn? Well, I learned this, and me too, okay. So the next we will change. And it was a continuous changing along some line, but it was a continuous changing, not to publish, but to understand. This was this great man, a great mind, Kolobov. He had the capability when everybody was looking, this is black, he said, no, this is white, maybe that you are looking with the wrong glasses.
So that was the beginning of starting to look at physiology, but also being a pioneer in developing techniques just from understanding physiology and see if these there worked on experiments on patients. And I think that was the beginning of intensive care. We are now, have moved on, and we still like to learn a lot about physiology, but we have entered the area of trials. And I'm receiving some questions from our team, and some questions that can probably be summarized in the, how do you explain the discrepancy between physiology and trial results? And I would elaborate, do you think there is a discrepancy, or do you think there is a mistake in the way we consider this?
Dangerous territory. Okay, for trials you need 1 gram of brain and 2 million of patients. For a physiology you need 2 kilos of brain and 10 patients.
That's a very provocative answer, but I also know from your CV.
Well, I ask your or all your man colleagues, no? Tell me one study. That teach us something about the mechanism through a big randomized trial. I speak in the trial we do. So with the syndrome, with sepsis, with that. Tell me one. I can tell you an example. That for meditation, sepsis. If I ask Maurizio, what's a sepsis? Sepsis is a terrible disease, no, excuse me, terrible syndrome. Which in which the guilty is not the bacteria, but is the our body, the reaction. And we have cytokine storm. Cytokine storm exists, does not exist. Anyway, this is cytokine storm. This is born from, I think, Oslo 100 years ago. After that, okay, if this is the observation, which is the basis of the scientific method, this generates one hypothesis. If the observation generates the theory that is the bacteria or the virus, the response, the body, our body response, the hypothesis is, if so, if I correct our response, I will improve outcome. We did since 100 years, thousands of experiments, no one showed that decreasing the response improved outcome. And so we say, la la la, mon frère, we will say, this is a heterogeneous population. Oh no, wait a second, it's a wrong time. Why not to say very simply that maybe the theory is wrong?
Let me ask more dangerous questions, because people that hear you talking now, they may think that you don't like trials, but I've read your CV and you have actually conducted and published a few trials. I mean, I remember the New England on the SVO2, yeah. You know, more recently on albumin. So what were you searching then when you were finding trials, and what did you find?
Do you want to be very sincere? At my age, I don't have any problem. For the first time in the New England, I had one real strong motivation. I wanted to have one paper on the New England, that's it. And to be published in the New England, you needed this kind of approach. And but was not very stupid, because at that time the supranormal values, a lot of my distinguished colleagues now say supranormal values is absolutely crazy. You should have heard them 30 years ago. Supranormal values, according to Schumacher and so on, was, I don't say a dogma, but was a strong drive. In this trial, we found that were exactly, having a supranormal value, exactly as to have a normal values. The interesting in this trial, we had three groups, and the number of death was not similar, was identical. 271, 271, 270, something like that. And the trial, I think, is the end stage demonstration to introduce something new of which you know and you studied the mechanism before, to have this technique accepted by the community, because it's a part of our scientific method, but it's not the scientific method. Is part of that.
And I think with that, with that trial, at the same time, there was the reverse, which was positive, but I think that contributed a lot also to understand the concept of timings and when to look for, for manipulating thermodynamics.
The reverse trial came about 10 years after our trial. And I was pleased to see something. The only explanation I had for the trial was the intensity of the care. And where has been done in emergency department, not in intensive care, because when we did our trial, the starting point, let's say, of SVO2 was exactly the similar in the three groups and very similar to the target. So we were already at the target.
Yeah.
I never saw SVO2 was 46, 50 as in the river.
And I think you mentioned something important there, the intensity of what we do and how early we do it in sepsis. Probably that was one of the strongest contribution from rivers. Indeed, probably the latest studies that were negative, in a way, it was a bit like having rivers against himself, Everyone changed because everyone was proactive about treating these patients, and probably many had already achieved those targets. So what do you think we get out of trials now? Because I personally think we still get a lot of information out of these trials, but maybe in a slightly different way. It seems that we are maybe getting rid of therapies that are either dangerous or maybe they are superfluous. But that's probably important information to test our knowledge forward. But what's your take on this?
Well, I think it's quite simple. I agree with you first. Second, we have three kinds of therapy. We have the therapy with etiological. We cure the etiology, and very not very popular in intensive care. Our trials are usually concentrated on symptomatic therapy. That means to keeping the patient alive while the pathophysiology is took care cytokine storm, this kind of thing, we keep the patient alive. Typically, is a mechanical ventilation or the hemodynamic treatment and so on. Now, when we have a positive trial, we do not improve survival. We do decrease the mortality due to the doctors. Our biggest achievement is not to do damage. 6 milliliters per kilo, 3, 2, 0, no, 12, etc., etc.
So and I think that's an important message, Luciano. The first, do no harm. We've seen it in this pandemic. Sometimes how much the rush to do something sometimes may cause more harm than good. And I think we've learned a lot that probably a lot of our job is actually preventing harm and giving time to patients to heal, which brings me to a question about one of your research achievements. You've always talked a lot about the clinical examination, but you have probably introduced the concept of also implementing and enhancing the clinical examination also with some imaging. And how did the idea of the baby lung came out? How did you think about, you know, maybe we have a smaller lung to care, a smaller healthy lung to care for, so we have to be maybe a bit more gentle, which to me is the key message of
It's quite simple, because in Europe, we had a group of people, no? In which were myself, Maurice Lamy, Ed Esternia, Peter Suter, we were 10, 11, Book Hill and Bucardi. We were meeting at our own expenses every 6 months in one of the places of, and everybody was communicating his own research. And after hearing Goran and Esternia speaking about the atelectasis in patient in during anesthesia, mm-hmm. at the number three, say, oh my God, why not to use in RDS? So I say, well, Goran, do you mind? I don't mind. And because it's impossible in Sweden, in Stockholm. Was impossible with our radiologist, because radiologist is absolutely useless to do the CT scan in RDS, which is diffuse disease. So one paying a black money, the technician, on a Friday night, we went in three, two doctors and four, two nurses, and the technician of the radiology, and we did the first CT scan, which was just curiosity. But I remember I was shivering when I saw this image, because it appears something that everybody now is accustomed to see. But when you grow up with some idea and you see that you have something completely different and you have to change completely your idea, which is the great thing of the research, when you find something that you do not expect. This is the key point. The outlier is the discovery, not the average.
And was it a similar story also for the proning, when you thought about
the proning was the consequence, because the baby lung was up, and so we were putting the baby lung down to have a better perfusion. After 2 years, they were doing that, and the PO2 went up, so we were very happy. And my friend Fumagalli, he was a student at the time, he told me, well, let's see, can I do a CT scan? Of course, so you show how we are intelligent. And of course, the CT scan found something completely different, because the baby lung disappeared. The density moved.
Yeah.
Concept which is not really still entered in the mind of the people, because very few use this extremely powerful instrument to understand the mechanism.
Yeah, so if you have to say something to a young intensivist or to a young trainee that is approaching a patient with respiratory failure, we've seen so many this year, probably we've never seen as many in a year as in the last 15 months. What would be a couple of tips that you would tell this person?
Well, first, I would suggest something that I almost never succeed in obtaining, is to convince the people that do not exist the clinical attitude and the research as a two different world. Each patient is a research. In each patient, we have to discover something. In each patient, we have to understand the mechanism. Until we will not overcome this dichotomy, which is very common, happens to me very rarely in my life, to work with the unity of all the people, research and the clinical together. But when you reach that, is as to sound and sing or to play in one orchestra. You are part of a beautiful harmony.
Which probably makes me guess the answer to this question that we're getting from the audience, which is, how much time did you devote towards patient care and how much time towards research before you retired?
If you have this starting, When I say, well, what do you research? On a Wednesday afternoon, I start to laugh. Wednesday night, Wednesday afternoon, I prefer to go to fish and look and waiting and thinking of what I say also maybe in the morning. Kind of dichotomy. I know that the world is going in another direction, but you know, this is what I think.
And Luciano, the on top of the these contributions is also your experience with ECMO. You've seen ECMO being developed and changing and trials, and again we start to understand a bit more where to use it, where not to use it. Where do you see this going? If you have to imagine the next 20, 30 years, I often think about, you remember dialysis of hemofiltration machines. 30 years ago, it was like you had to be in a very specific unit to have it, and they kind of become, you know, mainstream. Basically, you cannot have an intensive care without one now. Is something like this going to occur also for ECMO in the future, or where do you see it going?
Well, I don't have an answer for that, because when you say 28 years, really, it's not my problem, basically. But just to answer a little bit to that, my approach would be a little bit different. In these particular patients, having maybe improved the technology and so on, the combination of ECMO or CO2 removal plus some modified mechanical ventilation is less equal or more dangerous than mechanical ventilation alone. This is a key question to be posed before connecting whatever patient, and you don't find an answer in the trial with that, because with the trial we know that with the ECMO we do not kill, which is already a great advantage. Because
I think that's the key message, is that, you know, we need to carry on learning physiology, and with trials at least up to this moment, but I have some hope that maybe they will change soon, is that we have tested one therapy and we see what is harmful or what is not working. But you may have seen recently during this pandemic, you know, the speed of some of the trials, their so-called adaptive designs, maybe bringing the concept of phenotype to individualized treatments. Because what I've never seen so far is, for instance, a trial that randomized patients to receive the right treatment for that phenotype. We still go to one treatment or the other. What I would like to see is that based on physiology, you give something different. The characterization of this, even with data science and artificial, it's opening a new era. Is there something that you have watched a little bit as a development? Is something that you're interested on? Or what's your take on this?
No, I think that I'm absolutely convinced that for what we know, the diagnostic tool, the possibility with artificial intelligence, of which I do not know absolutely anything, but will improve our way to understand on how precise we are in that. There is no doubt that will what happen. I do not know how much of the creativity is in that. I repeat, I do not recall any discovery of mechanism with the big trials. And with ECMO, you find that the most, I think COVID, at the end of the COVID story, I mean, the COVID disclosed and a tremendous ignorance in our community, plus good things. Why I say that? Look at the literature. We have thousands of papers, okay? And most of them are low-level epidemiology. I put prone 10 patients. Well, I put 100. I put 500. I put 2 million. Good. And then 30% response, 40%. Who cares? My question is, why Mr. John responded and Mr. Smith did not. Once again, which is the mechanism behind? And you do not understand that we're millions of people, that's it. You like or you dislike. This is the reality. But is it tremendous the amount of epidemiology is in present at the moment. And epidemiology is the first step of the scientific method. When you collect the observation, then you need the theory, then you need the hypothesis, then you need to verify the hypothesis, then you need to falsify the hypothesis, blah, 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 and back again. We are very far from that still.
I agree with you. I would just like to make a comment about the, you know, the COVID has shown some of the weaknesses that you have highlighted of our community, but also the strength, you know,
absolutely,
of how much
of course
we got together in this. We have 1 minute to go. You know, you've been a past president of our society. You've seen it all. You're really seeing intensive care medicine growing. What would you like to see to or to say actually, not to see, to say, to a young trainee in intensive care?
That probably this is the most fascinating work possible for a man. With just one caution, be careful that we are not God. We are not owner of the life and of the death. Sometimes of the death, not of the life. Step forward has to be done, but is absolutely fascinating, attractive, and sometimes dangerous work. And whatever you do in your life, if you do intensive care, this will deeply change your life. You like or you don't like?
We like it. And with this, I would like to thank Luciano, you've been a fantastic first guest. And thank you everyone for the questions that you've been posting through social media. And thank you really, Luciano, for all your insights and sharing all parts of your life with us. Thank you all.
Ciao to everybody.
Ciao.
Wiedersehen.